lawmakers seeking to find solutions to the country's perennial problem of inadequate rice supply, leading to high prices of the staple grain. On the table, amending the rice tariffication law. The House of Representatives initially wanted to reinstate the power of the National Food Authority to import and sell rice. But the Senate is not in favor of the move. It plans to give the power to import rice to Agriculture Department instead. Why are we in this loop of rice problem, and what can be done to address it? We're now joined by former Agriculture Undersecretary Dr. Fermin Adriano. Thank you very much, Dr. Adriano, for joining us in the show.
Yes. Good afternoon. Good afternoon to you and your viewers.
Okay. So first off, what made the rice tariffication law in its current form ineffective in bringing down the prices of rice? Or do you think it's effective? It's just that the situation right now is very difficult.
I think that's some disinformation about the role of the RTL in bringing down the prices. If you look at it, since its approval or passage in 2019 to about 2022, the rice prices stabilized. In fact, rice inflation as a percent of inflation was negative and only up to 2% or something like that. So it was not the rice tariffication law per se that led to an increase in the prices of rice. There were two factors that led to the increase in rice prices, which actually began in 2022 with the outbreak of the Russia-Ukraine conflict. Because of that war, prices of petrol, wherein fertilizers is derived, and prices of corn and flour also increased because those two countries are major producers of flour and wheat, or wheat and corn. And that's the reason why there was already a tight commodity supply during that time. And in 2023, that was the real thing. You know, if you look at the graphs, it was actual after the announcement of the Indian government to ban the export of non-basmati, meaning white rice, in the global market. India constitute about 40% of total global export. So if bans exporting, that means that the world supply will be seriously affected. And that's what happened. You know, if you look at the graphs, it was really that single factor. And some contemplated in following India's decision because they thought that they have to guarantee their food security, which created a lot of trembles in the rice supply market. So it was not RTL that led to the price increases. It was external factors. And secondly, if you look at it, the RTL provided certain provisions that will allow us to address short-term rice, supply problem. The first is that the RTL specifically or stipulated that the NMA should buy the palay or the stocks from the farmers so that it can build a buffer stock for emergency. And in fact, even sold its stock at a scandalously low price of 25 pesos per kilo. And that became the basis of the ombudsman case against some of those officials who were suspended, about more than 100 of them. Secondly, RTL also provided in its implementing rules and regulations that the government can import directly, but not through NFA. It can import through an agency called Philippine International Trading Corporations or Trade Corporations under the DTI. Again, they did not take advantage of that. Nobody did. There seems to be hesitance to use that route. So in other words, it's not the fault of the law. It's an institutional issue. It's a managerial issue.
So right now, so you're saying under the current form of the rice tariffication law, the government can actually import. But,
yes.
Yeah, but right now, they're talking about giving the Department of Agriculture the power to import rice or, reinstating the power of the NFA to import rice. So, I mean, what are your thoughts on that? I mean, should we even be talking about this?
It's a bad policy advice because we know in the past, there are several things that happened in the past. First, NFA incurred a gargantuan or humongous debt of more than 150 billion pesos. It's a debt that the public has to pay. taxpayers money. Secondly, it was attended by a lot of graft and corruption. Because it's an open secret that if you buy from wholesalers, that's a commission of about, it used to be before, 35 centavos to 50 centavos per kilo. So if you're talking about 1 million metric tons, there's a commission of between 3.5 to 5 billion pesos. I don't know where it goes. But that was the, you know, that was the market process during that time. Thirdly, NFA wasn't able to be successful in stabilizing rice prices. It kept on increasing. In fact, in 2018, remember that the rice price increase in 2018? NFA was heavily intervening in the market, but it was not able to prevent it. Why? Because it can only buy in terms of the local production, less than 2% or 2% of the total production of our palay farmers. To be able to stabilize prices or influence market, you have to buy about 10% of the total supply. So, if you do that, you have to have massive amount of money to give to the NFA. So, in other words, you know, I always keep on citing Albert Einstein on this matter. It is, you know, he said that it is the height of foolishness to keep on repeating something and you expect a different results.
Do you think we can, or the government can still achieve its promise of a 20 peso per kilo rice?
Well, we're entitled to dream. Everybody's entitled to dream. Yung 30 na nga lang, mahirapan na, April. Yung pang 20, just ko naman. Kasi, just imagine, the farm gate cost of palay, palay pa lang yun, is already naglalaro 23 and upwards. To be able to do this 1 kilo price, you need 2 kilos of palay. That will include your drying, etc., even transportation. So, 23 pesos, sabi mo lang 23, 46 na yun, di ba? Eh, bibili mo ng 20 yung palay, so you will be losing 26 pesos for every kilo of palay, of rice that you will. So it's not logical. I mean, it's not pragmatic, I think, ano, di ba? Eh, 30 nga lang, hirap na eh, kasi 46 nga eh. Tapos 16 pesos ang ano mo. Unless money is pouring like mana from heaven, I think that will be feasible. Or the other choice is that you starve other departments of their budget and just put it to rice. Mm-hmm. So you close down the Department of Health, you close down the Department of Education, you put all the money to rice. Or you close down the operation of the military. That's all. Di ba? Yeah, that will become feasible. Eh, unfortunately, it's not. I don't think it's a solution. I don't think.
It's not a long-term solution, and I don't think the government is financially healthy enough to provide such subsidies at this point.
Mahirap talaga, April. Kasi ang magagawa lang natin as a professor, there's a guy, professor, whose name is. He's an agricultural economist guru. He's from Harvard, formerly with Stanford. His name is C. Peter Timmer. He's a friend of ours before. He used to visit the Philippines. And he already looked at this issue of rice. And he said that it is impossible to check the rising prices of rice and other commodities because of external factors, this problem. And more recently, and more... You know, now in the news always, only flavor of the month, climate change. Yes. It makes it more expensive to produce agriculture products because of climate change, because you need more water, you have to change the technology. So because of those factors, he said, it is nearly impossible to check the rising prices of rice and other critical staple commodities. What can the government can do, however, is to ensure two things. Ensure that the price increases will be gradual instead of being drastic. Because if it's drastic, it will create social discontentment. That's what he said in his article. Totoo naman talaga.
Yes.
Just like what happened in Egypt, di ba? Yung wheat, ano nila yung bread? when prices shoot up because it was so drastic, it created social unrest in Egypt. But if prices gradually increases, yeah, there will be talk about it, but it will not create social discontent on our streets, ano, yung mga rally or something like that.
Yeah, people will adjust.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Tapos sasabihin nila, oh, pakainin mo lang kamote or other, ano, basaba. Kaso problema doon sa proposition nila, they say it's more nutritious. Kamote is more expensive than rice per kilo, 70, 80, di ba? Yun din yung saging saba, it's more expensive. And even yung, ano, yung kamoteng kahoy, it's more expensive than rice. That's the reason why people, the poor, are prepared to consume rice because it is the cheapest staple available still. Even corn is more expensive than rice. And then the other factor is the storage capability because rice will last for about, if you store it, 46 months. The others, pwede ba naman yung saba na i-store mo, di patay, bulok agad yun, di ba? It will ripen so fast. Yun ang hindi naiintindihan ng mga commentators who become experts on the matter. You know?
Okay.
Overnight expert.
Thank you so much, thank you, sir, for your thoughts on, you know, rice. Yeah, and agriculture in general.